So number five on worksheet two, let R be the region bounded by the graphs of y equals sine of pi x and y equals x cubed minus 4x, as shown in the figure on the right. I'm guessing it's a calculator problem because it doesn't say not to use a calculator. So I could use a calculator to figure out which one's which, but that sure looks like a sine wave, and I know the sine of 0, 0, so I'm pretty sure that top one is sine of pi x, and that bottom one would be x cubed minus 4x. Okay, again, if you didn't know that or you couldn't tell that, you put them in the calculator and see which one's which. Find the area. Okay, so area would be, I'm going to go dx, so top minus bottom, sine of pi x minus, out of space. I'm going to call it y2. I'm probably going to put these in the calculator. That way I don't have to type it in all the time from 0 to 2. So after saying I didn't need to graph it on the calculator, I'm going to type it in anyway. Sine of pi x. And then x cubed minus 4x. May as well graph it to make sure I'm looking at the right thing. It's nice when they sort of provide the window for me. I'm going to go one past it, so I'm going to go negative 1 to 3, and then negative 4 to 2. My picture should look pretty similar to the picture they give us there. So there's the sine graph. And then there's the x cubed graph. Okay. So I think I'm ready to do math 9. 0 to 2. I should probably label these. Oh, I did. y1 minus y2. y1 minus y2 dx. And that area is just 4. Kind of weird that it worked out nice and neat. Part B. The horizontal line y equals negative 2 splits the region into two parts, but definitely not two equal parts, right? Like this is not a, we've done a couple of those, but that's not two equal parts. Two parts. Write but do not evaluate an integral expression for the area of R that is below the horizontal line. Area of R below the horizontal line. So let's see. So that would be that area. Okay, so I can ignore all this other stuff going on, which means that pi x stuff doesn't even enter in, I don't think. So I'm just going to do top minus bottom from, here's my problem, from wherever that is to wherever that is. So I need to figure out A and B. So the integral from A to B, top minus bottom dx. I'll figure out A and B in a minute. The top is minus 2, and the bottom is, I'm just going to call it, I can call it y2. I can do that because I've labeled what y2 is. So I can use new variables. I can introduce new variables into a problem as long as I tell the grader what that variable means. So I'm good to use a's and b's and y2's as long as I've said what those are. Speaking of which, so does this answer the question? Write but do not evaluate an integral that finds that area? Am I good with this? Why not? I didn't find A and B. So this probably would get partial credit because they probably would be looking for, like when you're grading, it tells you that, you know, if they get the integrand right, that's worth a point. If they get the limits right, that's worth a point. And so I'd probably get half the points on this, but I need to go figure out what A and B are. So back to this calculator. I want to look at negative 2. And you know what? I think I'm just going to turn off the sine graph because I don't even want that on there. So you can highlight the equal sign, press enter on it, and that turns it off. So it's still in there in case I need it for the rest of this problem. But when it comes to the graph, if I don't want to see it, I can turn it off. Again, it's not really in the way, so it wouldn't be a big deal on this one. But that's just a nice feature that if you want to keep the graph, but you don't want to see the graph, then turn it off. Okay, so I got to figure out where A and B are. Second calc, intersection. It also means my first curve and second curve I don't have to worry about because there are only two curves on the graph. Ooh, that's a yucky answer. 0.53918887. But I don't have to do anything with that, and since all I have to do is write the integral, like, that's fine. That's all I have to say. For B, same thing. Intersection, first curve, second curve. And then go find that second x value where they intersect. 1.675, 1309. And I think I'm good now. Again, even though this has A's and B's and Y2's, I told the grader what A is, told the grader what B is. I labeled Y2, so I think I'm good with that as an answer. And there is enough there to find it, but it just said do not evaluate, so I don't have to type it into the calculator. Part C. The region R, so now we're back to the whole region, is the base of a solid. Each cross-section perpendicular to the x-axis, we like that, that means it's dx, is a square, oh, we like that, because the area of a square is s squared. So I'm going to add up all the volumes, which means the cross-sectional area times the thickness from 0 to 2. Again, I'm probably writing more than you might want to. 0 to 2. The area of a square is s squared. Kind of tight on space here. That's top minus bottom, which is y1 minus y2. The sine minus the cubic. So I'm just going to put in y1 minus y2 squared. Y1 minus Y2 is the height of that of this piece, or the length of S. Y1 minus Y2. And if I square that, then I'll get the area of that square coming up out of the page. So, math 9 again. 0 to 2. Open parentheses so that I can get the squares in there. Y1 minus Y2, close parentheses squared, dx. And so that volume is 9.978. Part D. The region R models the surface of a small pond, okay? At all points in R, at a distance x from the y-axis, okay, so just x, the depth of the water is given by this thing. Find the volume of the water in the pond. So, let's see. So now I'm like top down, and now instead of thinking squares coming out of the page, I've got the depth, so I've got some pond like going into the page, but the depth I know. So I'm gonna add up all the volumes again. 0 to 2. And I know the height. Just put all these in here. I know the height. That's top minus bottom. I know the depth. That's 3 minus x. And I know the width. That's dx. So 0 to 2. I should be careful about calling that the height. That's the S. That's the distance across. So that's y1 minus y2. The depth, they told me, was 3 minus x. And the width of every slice is dx. So I can type that in the calculator and see what I get. Math 9, 0, 2. y1 minus y2 times 3 minus x dx, 8.370. Okay, that last one was kind of crazy. If I'm guessing the point distribution on this thing, it's probably, because this is probably an old AP test question, which means there's 9 points to divide up. There might be 3 on that last point. 2 or 3 on that last one. 1 or 2 on the first one, and probably 2s on the middle ones. I don't know if that adds up to 9, but that's close. All that to say is, if that last one was crazy, then you should probably get 6 out of 9 or 7 out of 9 before you hit that last one. And if you get 6 out of 9 on all of the problems, if you get 2/3 of the problem of the test right, you're going to make a 5. So again, it's built. Yeah, there's going to be some crazy stuff on there. And if you get any of the crazy parts, you should feel great. If you don't get any of the crazy parts, no big deal. Get the easy and the medium parts, and you got yourself a 4 or a 5. Get all the easy parts, you make a 3. Get some of the mediums, make a 4. Hit a few on a few of the 5, or a few of the hard parts, and make a 5. You don't even have to hit all of the hard parts. In fact, I think I'd say if you got all the easy and mediums right, you'd probably make you'd definitely make a 4 and maybe a 5. So when you hit that last question on the free response questions, it's always going to be something crazy, new, weird. Do your best. But if you don't get any points there, no big deal. Oh, also, timing is perfect. We can see that on the video there's 13 minutes. If this was an AP test question, generally you're allotted 15 minutes per free response question. And so we did it with 2 minutes to spare. Now, I knew what I was doing. But I also was slowing down and answering questions and showing work and doing lots of stuff. So generally speaking, time isn't an issue. Obviously, if you don't know a question and you spend 5 minutes on it, well, then time's going to be an issue. But generally speaking, time isn't really the problem. It's the calculus that's the problem. So even still, we've got a minute left if that was a 15-minute problem.